الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد بن عبد الله الأمين قائد الغر المحجلين وعلى آله الطاهرين الطيبين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا توبوا إلى الله توبة نصوحا. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم: التائب من الذنب كمن لا ذنب له. وقال عليه الصلاة والسلام: والله إني لأستغفر الله في كل يوم أكثر من 70 مرة، أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. My dear respected brothers, elders, friends and colleagues, brothers and sisters listening at home, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. It is indeed a great honor and privilege of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has given us the tawfiq to unite, to meet here in this Medina Masjid of Barbados. And I am grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to all my friends for your warm welcome, for your muhabbat, your love, your affection. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you in this dunya and also in the hereafter. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unite us in the hereafter in Jannat al-Firdaus, just as He has united us here in the world. My dear respected brothers, friends and colleagues, I wish to share with you a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the few minutes that we have. Imam Tirmidhi rahimahullah, a great scholar, Imam Abu Isa, Muhammad ibn Isa al-Tirmidhi, who authored a book of hadith known as Jami' al-Tirmidhi or Sunan al-Tirmidhi, one of the six hadith books which are studied in the final year of the Alim course, the Alim program. Six books of hadith. One of these six books is Jami' al-Tirmidhi, also known as Sunan al-Tirmidhi. The author is Imam Tirmidhi rahimahullah. He is known as Tirmidhi because he originated from the town of Tirmid. Tirmid is on the border of Afghanistan and Uzbekistan. It is in Uzbekistan, but it is right on the border. Imam Tirmidhi rahimahullah is from Tirmid. Alhamdulillah, a few years ago, 2019, before COVID, 1 year before COVID, we traveled to Uzbekistan with my respected father, Mufti Shabbir Sahib, Damat Farakatuhum, and Sheikh al-Islam, Mufti Muhammad Taqi Uthmani Sahib, Damat Farakatuhum. We traveled to Uzbekistan, we visited Bukhara, Samarkand, and we also visited Tirmidhi, and we visited the grave of Imam Tirmidhi rahimahullah, and we also visited the grave of Hakim Tirmidhi rahimahullah. He's another. There are many scholars from Tirmidhi. So Imam Tirmidhi rahimahullah, a great scholar. He is a student of Imam Bukhari rahimahullah. A student of Imam Bukhari rahimahullah. And he himself writes in his book that sometimes my teacher Imam Bukhari would hear hadiths from me. A true scholar, a true student of knowledge is the one who learns from his elders, from his contemporaries, and also from his students. Ye talib-e-ilm ki alamat hai. A person should not feel shy or afraid from learning from those who are younger than him, from his own students. So Imam Tirmidhi rahimahullah is narrating this hadith from a sahabi, Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. Now Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu is the son of Umar radiallahu anhu. And for the benefit of my young friends, in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there are four young Sahaba by the name of Abdullah who are known as Al-Abadilatul Arba'. The four Abdullahs who are young in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and each one is a shining star. One is Abdullah ibn Umar, the son of Umar radiallahu anhu. a great faqih, a great scholar. Each Sahabi has something unique about them. And Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, the unique aspect about him was his love of the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Today, our mentality is that we ask, is it fard? Is it wajib? Is it sunnah? Is it mustahab? Why? So that if it's mustahab, then we don't have to do it. If it's sunnah, then we don't have to do it. It's not wajib. It's not fard. These terminologies, fard, sunnah, wajib, mustahab, do not exist in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the way that it exists now. For the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did this, we also have to do this. This is why we have ikhtilaf and difference of opinion amongst the a'imma. That is this wajib, is the sunnah. Because these terminologies and the detailed categorization of ahkam divided into these categories did not exist at a high level, but did not exist with this amount of detail in the era of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My point being that Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, let alone the farz and the wajib and the sunnat and the mustahab, put that on to one side. But even in the ashya'i jibiliyya, in the non-tashri'i matters, non-religious matters, for example, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he traveled from Madinah al-Munawwara to Makkah al-Mukarramah, he stopped at certain places. He did qailula, siesta in certain places. He did istinja in certain places. Now it is not mustahab from a fiqhi perspective to stop at that place or to do istinja at that place. It is something Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did. But Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu has so much love for the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam every action. When he later in life, after the demise of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would travel from Madinah to Munawwara to Makkah to Mukarramah. Wherever Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had stopped for qailula, for siesta he would stop. Wherever Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had stopped for istinja, he would stop. And even if he did not have the taqaza of istinja, he did not have the urge of istinja, it wasn't the time of istinja for him, he would stop at that place and formulate the position as though he is doing istinja. This is how much love he had for the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in every aspect. So this is Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, a master of hadith, of fiqh, to the extent that the Maliki fiqh, the fiqh of Imam Malik rahimahullah, much of it is dependent on Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. Great scholar. He is one of the four young, the era of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was young. Young Sahabi. A shining star for our youngsters. Number two, Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. Imam of Tafsir, the Imam of Tafsir. He did khidmat for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made dua for him, Allahumma allimhu al-kitab. Oh Allah, teach him the Qur'an. Give him the knowledge of the Qur'an. He was very young in the era of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Young Sahabi. The cousin of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Number three, Abdullah ibn Zubayr radiallahu anhu. The son of Zubayr ibn Awam. Radiallahu anhu, and the son of Asma radiallahu anha, who is the daughter of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. So his nana is Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, Abdullah ibn Zubayr radiallahu anhu. Great companion. For a time he was in charge of Makkah al-Mukarramah, and then Hajjaj ibn Yusuf and some people from the Banu Umayyah, they killed him. In the era of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was also very young. And number four, Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu. The son of Amr ibn al-As, the one who conquered Egypt, Fatih of Misr. Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As radiallahu ta'ala anhu was also young in the era of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In their teens, all these four, Abdullah's in their teens. Who is he? Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu says regarding Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As radiallahu ta'ala anhu that there is no Sahabi who has more hadiths than me. Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu narrates thousands of hadiths. He says that there is no other Sahabi who possesses more hadiths of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam than me. فَإِنَّهُ كَانَ يَكْتُبُ وَأَنَا لَا أَكْتُبُ Because he would write down the hadiths and I would not write down them. Although in terms of the hadiths that have reached us, we have more hadiths of Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu than Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As. We have many of his hadiths, but in number, they are less than the number of hadiths of Abu Huraira that have reached us. But that is because of his students. The students narrated so many hadiths. Like Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu had thousands of hadiths. But only 16 hadiths of his have reached us. And one of the reasons behind this is that Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu passed away two and a half years after the demise of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And after that there were many other Sahaba who stayed alive who transmitted hadiths. So and they would transmit hadiths directly from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the hadith that Imam Tirmidhi rahimahullah is narrated from Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. He is one of the four young Abdullahs. There were also other Abdullahs like Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, but he was elder. From the young ones, these are the four. He says that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that in the Banu Ismail there was a person by the name of Al-Kifl. And Al-Kifl was a sinner. There was no sin that Al-Kifl had not committed. There was no sin that Al-Kifl had not committed. One day, he was about to commit zina. And he agreed to give 60 dinars, 60 gold coins, to a lady. Dinar is a gold coin. Dirham is a silver coin. One dinar, I have done the calculation on my website. You can see it there in terms of the value of one dinar. I don't remember now at this moment in time. But it is very expensive. Gold is very expensive. One dinar is a few grams. So 60 times it, you multiply it in the thousands of pounds. She agreed to commit zina with him, Al-Kifl. When he sat down over her to commit the sin, she started to shiver. And she started to cry. Tears were flowing from her eyes. So Al-Kifl says to her, why are you crying? Why are you shivering? Am I forcing you? She says, no. It's my consent. But I have never ever committed this sin. And the only reason I am committing this sin is because of poverty and because of need. هذا الفقر أن يكون كفرًا. Sometimes poverty leads you to disbelief, leads you to commit sins. The penny dropped on Al-Kifl. You see, tawfiq is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The penny dropped. Suddenly Al-Kifl stood up and said to her, you go, and the money is also yours. The 60 dinars is also yours, and you go. And he said, Wallahi la aqsil laha abada. Wallahi, I will never ever disobey you, Ya Allah, ever. I will never ever disobey you. فَمَاتَ فِي لَيْلَتِهِ الْعَلِيكَ Al-Kifl passes away that night. Al-Kifl passes away that night. What do the people think about him? That he is a sinner, there is no sin that he has not committed. People don't know about what happened between him and this lady. But between him, the lady, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the morning, when people woke up, there was no sign of Al-Kifl. People thought, where is Al-Kifl? No sign of Al-Kifl. Al-Kifl had not exited from the house. People went to his house and something was written on the door of Al-Kifl. إِنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ غَفَرَ لِلْكِفْلِ Imagine, he is the sinner of the... He is known to be the greatest sinner. There is no sin that he has not committed. How does Allah Ta'ala reward him and compensate him? Written on his door, he has passed away. إِنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ غَفَرَ لِلْكِفْرِ. Indeed, Allah has forgiven al-kifr. Allah Ta'ala ne kifr ki maghfirat farmayi. Why? Because he did tawbah. We don't have the time to talk about tawbah. There are three components of tawbah. So you should remember this. Three components of tawbah. Number one, remorse. Remorse, nadamat. And inner regret. Ya Allah, what sin have I committed? Number two, to abstain from the sin. To stop committing the sin. Obviously, in the shop, the alcohol is still being sold that you're making tawbah. That's not tawbah. That is a joke. And number three, to Al-Kifl, he had remorse, he stopped committing the sin. And number three, a firm intention that I will never ever commit the sin again. If a person in his mind thinks in the month of Ramadan that let Eid day come and I will resume my activity, my sinful activity, that's not tawbah. Tawbah is these three things. If you ponder upon these three things, you will realize that tawbah does not even require you to do anything. You don't even have to say anything for tawbah. Remorse is in the heart. To stop committing the sin, you stop. You don't have to do anything physically. Unless it is to do with hukul al-ibad and you have to pay someone. That's a separate matter. And number three, a firm intention. Intention is of the heart and the mind. So for tawbah, you don't even have to say anything. You don't have to do anything. This is what differentiates tawbah and istighfar. Istighfar, you say astaghfirullah, you say Allah Ta'ala's forgiveness. But tawbah, you don't even have to say anything. This is why tawbah, you can't ask somebody else to do tawbah for you. Istighfar, you can ask somebody else. When we read Salatul Janazah, we make dua of maghfirah. واستغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات making dua of istighfar for the believers اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات. You can make dua of maghfirah for somebody else, but you can't do tawbah on behalf of somebody else, because tawbah is these three things. Somebody else can't have this feeling for you. So what we learn from the story of Al-Kifr is tawbah, and the door of tawbah is open. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَخْبَرُ تَوْبَةَ الْعَبْدِ مَا لَمْ يُغَرْغِرْ. Hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, indeed Allah accepts the tawbah of the servant until the gargling noise, until the ruh and the soul is about to leave the body and may starts to make the gargling noise, until that point the door of tawbah is open. Allah Ta'ala is calling out to us, come to me, walk to me and I will run to you. Walk to me and I will run to you. And today my brothers and mothers and sisters listening at home, the ummah is in need of tawbah and istighfar. وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُعَذِّبَهُمْ وَأَنْتَ فِيهِمْ وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ مُعَذِّبَهُمْ وَهُمْ يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ. Our respected teacher, Brother Sheikh Maulana Muhammad Yunus Sahib George Puri, Nawallahu Barqalahu, would say, and I conclude, that the wujud, the existence of Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in itself was a means of protection from umumi azab, umumi general punishment. And after the demise of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if there is something that can prevent general adab, umumi punishment, then it is istighfar and tawbah. Istighfar. This is what we learn from the story of Al-Kifl, my dear brothers. As I mentioned yesterday, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, imagine, this is a sinner. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not only did he convey to the Banu Israel, but he conveyed to me and you until the day of Qiyamah that Al-Kifl has been forgiven. He may have been a sinner throughout his life, but before he passed away, he repented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Me and you should not be the judge for somebody else. How our final moments will be before we pass away, only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. وَالْأَعْمَالُ بِالْخَوَاتِيمِ. An action actions are according to their ending. Al-Kibdi Tawbah, and then he passed away. Leave it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do the right thing and leave it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has his own means and methods of communicating to humanity. That Al-Kafir may have been a sinner, but I have communicated to the entire mankind to come until the day of Qiyamah that Al-Kafir has been forgiven. What more do you want? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us a tawfiq. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to repent to Him, to turn to Him. Every day, my dear brothers, at night before we go to sleep, we reflect upon our a'mal and deeds throughout. Just 2 minutes before we go to sleep, 2 minutes, just think about our day. And but how have we spent our day? Have we wronged anybody? Have we wronged Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? If the angel of death comes to us, are we ready? Are we not ready? We make tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And tawbah is very, very easy. Yes, there are salat tawbah, and there are ad'iyah and du'as. These are all bonuses. These are all declarations. But fundamentally, these three components are tawbah. And tawbah can be done at any time, anywhere, at any place, and it doesn't require any place. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillah.